Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on pathways to recovery, update on progress and milestones for expanding access to residential rehabilitation in Scotland. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Minister Angela Constance, up to 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, we carry a national shame of thousands of heartbreaking drug-related deaths, and it's my job as Minister for Drugs Policy to lead the national mission to turn the tide on this crisis. When speaking to people in recovery, I'm often reminded that stopping someone from dying is only the beginning of the recovery journey. Recovery isn't something which happens to people. It happens when the systems of services and resources facilitate individuals to build recovery capital, social connections, and pursue their recovery goals safely. The system of services needs to be based on hope and trust to meet people where they are and not leave them there. And it's with that word hope in mind that I come before Parliament today to provide an update on our progress on residential rehabilitation and set out our milestones for the road ahead. Our national mission to tackle the drugs deaths emergency is focused on a public health response to save but also improve lives, whether that is through harm reduction services, medicated assisted treatment, abstinence programmes or support for mental health, housing and welfare. This is about supporting people to access the treatment and recovery that is right for them. Therefore, we are working to ensure that all the component parts of a recovery-orientated system of care operate effectively with good links and pathways between them to reduce harm and promote recovery. Residential rehabilitation must be part of this range of evidence-based prevention, treatment and recovery services. This will ensure that there are options and choice for those who want to seek an abstinence-based recovery. There are three parts to our national approach towards achieving this: improving pathways into and from residential rehabilitation, in particular for those with multiple and complex needs; investing in a significant increase in the capacity of residential rehabilitation; and developing a standardised approach to commissioning residential services also. Today we have published a suite of reports detailing the current state of pathways into, through and from rehab. The research undertaken by government has highlighted areas which do not have clear pathways, and this has enabled us to tailor and target our interventions to the areas where it's hardest to access rehab. Pathways into and between all types of services are important, but this is even more vital for residential rehab because it is all too often not part of the range of options available. Also, we know that the transition from rehab back into the community is a higher risk phase, so it's important to get it right with reintegration into other services such as housing and employability. Pathways to residential rehab and aftercare should be clear, consistent and easy to navigate no matter what area of Scotland you live in. We want to ensure that people feel supported and have more choice in their treatment journey, and that a no wrong door approach means that they can ask for help through a variety of services, including housing, criminal justice and community outreach. And the tragic statistics published today on homelessness deaths, more than half of which are linked to drugs, make this an ever greater priority. We will be ensuring a rights-based approach by applying the panel principles of participation, accountability, non-discrimination, empowerment and legality in the development of all pathways in all ADP areas. By summer next year, we will ensure that each ADP has a published pathway document to share with clinicians, social workers and outreach workers, as well as individuals and their families. We have responded to calls for more transparency and accountability by working with Public Health Scotland to track the number of residential rehab placements the ADPs have funded. And this will provide government with a clear line of sight on how the residential rehab money is being spent. So far, in the first 6 months of this financial year, ADPs have funded 212 placements, an investment of around £1.4 million from the £5 million allocated to be spent on residential rehab and aftercare this year. This is almost the same is the number of placements funded annually in 2019-20. But let me be crystal clear, it will be unacceptable for any area not to be investing in residential rehab. We are aiming to increase the number of publicly funded placements by more than 300% over the 5 years of this programme, so that by 2026, at least 1,000 people every year are publicly funded for their rehab placement. We will work with ADPs to support the delivery of this ambition and to facilitate regional approaches, especially in those areas where the rate of drug deaths are highest and access to residential rehab is most challenging. Regional hubs overseen by Healthcare Improvement Scotland will ensure the local system of treatment and recovery services, including residential rehab, are operating to the highest of standards. In order to facilitate the increase in publicly funded placements, we are working to increase capacity. And this builds on the recommendations from the Residential Rehabilitation Working Group, who I'm very grateful to ensure equal access across Scotland. The total estimated number of rehab beds available in Scotland just now is 425. Our aim is that by 2026, there will be 50% more rehab beds in Scotland, a total of 650. We have established a rapid capacity programme as part of the Recovery Fund, which will expand existing services and establish new services. Our surveys highlighted a gap in provision that meets the needs of women and those who require childcare facilities, and so we have made this a focus for the programme. We have already committed to just over £8 million of funding over the next 5 years to support a new national family service to be delivered by Phoenix Futures. This service, which will be up and running by summer 2022, will support up to 20 families at any one time. I am pleased to announce today to Parliament that we are also providing funding to expand the capacity of the Lothian and Edinburgh Abstinence Programme, LEAP, by 40%. The funding will enable the detox capacity in the Ritson Clinic to increase by 50%. This will enable more people to safely detox before going into the LEAP service. And the project will be delivered in partnership with the Lothian ADPs and will act as a blueprint for a regional model of delivery to address inequities of access across Scotland. I can also announce to Parliament today that in recognition of the fact that one size does not fit all and that there is a need for diversity of residential rehabilitation options, we are also funding River Garden to scale up their innovative residential therapeutic community and social enterprise. Based on the experience of international models in Italy, Sweden and the USA, River Garden offers a 3-year residential programme for people in the early stages of recovery. The service currently supports 7 residents and this funding will enable them to realise their vision of supporting 56 men and women in recovery. This brings us to a total of £18 million of investment so far from the Recovery Fund, which will increase capacity and ensure choice. In order to more fundamentally transform the way residential rehab beds and placements are funded, we are developing standardised approaches to commissioning rehab services. Subject to the outcome of the National Care Service consultation, government may take a national approach to commissioning specialist addiction services. Whilst the National Care Service has the potential to reform how services such as rehab, detox and stabilisation are commissioned and procured, we do not need to wait until the more systematic changes are made. That's why we have asked Scotland Excel, as the centre of procurement expertise in local authorities, to undertake market analysis and further engagement with ADPs to consider what the different routes available to government are now. When the First Minister and I recently visited Blue Vale Community Club, we emphasised that no ideas are off the table, as problems and solutions belong to us all. We want to build a political consensus around what works, and for example, we welcome the recognition across this Parliament that safer drug consumption facilities have a role to play in saving and improving lives. Presiding Officer, today I have outlined the work we are undertaking over the next 5 years to ensure that everyone who wants residential rehabilitation and for who it is considered clinically appropriate can access it. And my priorities are on making people's rights real by funding and shaping new services, supporting the development of clear pathways and reforming the commissioning model. The national mission is not about residential rehabilitation over MAT standards. It's not about giving priority to abstinence over harm reduction. This is about supporting people. This is about getting more people into the treatment and recovery that is right for them. And by doing so, we can help people flourish and feel hopeful about their futures. And we as a country can see through this crisis to a better time. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. I call on Sue Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank the Minister for advance citing of her statement and the many attachments that came with it this afternoon. In October, the Scottish Government held a debate on a person-centred approach to mental health and substance abuse. Today, we have heard again about the importance of getting more people into the treatment and recovery that is right for them. The problem with the idea and ideology of person-centred care is that, in reality, the care people receive is system-centred or organisation-centred. Patients generally get what the system or organisation is willing and able to deliver, not what they want or need. What guarantees can the Minister give us that person-centred care will be centred around the person and not around the ability of providers to deliver a service?
Minister.
Sir, and I very much appreciate Sue Webber's contribution. Can I say I also understand that there was a wide variety of attachments and publications that have underpinned this statement today. There is a wealth of information that we have published, and with Ms Webber or indeed any other MSP, I'm happy to engage further on the detail in and around that, because actually boring into the detail is absolutely crucial here if we are to redesign systems of care, whether that's community services or indeed residential rehabilitation services that meet the needs of individuals and not providers and not local authorities and not government. We have to have the person at the absolute centre of this. And while I appreciate that much of what I've published today may be less than politically sexy, if I can put it that way, but it is important to bore into the detail of where the money is being spent, to understand where the gaps in provision are, to sort out pathways so that they are clear and consistent and easy to navigate across the country, as well as investing in services to use existing capacity, but also to build that capacity. And much of our work around national commissioning and a regional approach, it will help us change the systems, not to be meeting the self-perpetuating needs of the system, but to meet the needs of our people who need treatment. And it's treatment that is right for them, not right for us.
Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome today's report and advance sight of the statement. It does show that some progress has been made, and that's to be welcomed. I do, however, want to introduce a note of caution in how we frame this discussion. I welcome that the Minister mentions harm reduction. We must not stigmatise people who use opiate substitutes as a way to address their addiction. It is a legitimate treatment option, and if we are serious about bringing Scotland's fatalities to an end, it is part of the response. I have a few questions about the statement. While the increase in placements are positive, the Residential Rehab Monitoring Funded Places recent report shows significant differences by ADP, so when will the postcode lottery come to an end? Can I also ask about fatalities of those under 25, where we've seen an increase, and there's also recognition as a lack of access to specialist treatment for young people, including rehab, so what facilities are planned for young people? And the final question is to ask the Minister if she's confident the resources in place are sufficient, and is she monitoring whether there are any increased changes in the cost to residential rehab?
Minister.
Right, thank you, Presiding Officer. I will try and cover all of that as quickly as I can. I'm grateful to Ms Baker for her recognition of the progress that we are making. I absolutely endorse about what she's saying about not stigmatising opiate substitute therapy or harm reduction. That is one of the reasons why we are taking a whole systems approach, and we talk about that wider system of care where all the parts need to complement and fit together. She will also note that we are increasing placements significantly, and I hope that that will be welcomed across the Chamber. In terms of phase one of the rapid residential rehab recovery programme, we are investing £18 million, and this equates to at least 77 beds. It will increase capacity by around 18%, and you know, is a significant step forward. But she is right to say what is next. And while we have had a particular focus on families and women, and our work there is far from done, we do need to think much more about where services need to be, particularly for young people. Because what we've seen over the last few years is a growing amount of young people either being admitted to hospital or tragically losing their lives. The homelessness statistics today and those tragic deaths, which are also preventable, I think means that we need to, with even more haste, think about how we support those with multiple and complex needs. And we also, this £18 million investment is a great boost to services across the central belt of Scotland, and our investment in the Lothians in particular will give us a blueprint for expansion elsewhere. But we need to have a really close and look at the acute needs that also exist in our rural communities.
Thank you. And I call Gillian Martin to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The expansion of residential rehabilitation is welcome. However, the Minister has outlined in their statement the importance of a range of different types of treatments being required and available. Can the Minister give an indication of what role community services will play as access to rehab is expanded? And I'm particularly aware that that period after residential rehab is particularly crucial.
Minister.
Thank you. I mean, that's a really important point, that over the piece, it's really important that we don't consider residential rehabilitation in isolation. And we need to remember that community services are key to the success of residential rehabilitation. And this is about the need to provide continuity of care. This is about the preparation that people need prior to entering rehab. And this is also crucially about the aftercare that people receive. And we need to be thinking about that aftercare on a much more long-term basis. This isn't people coming out of residential rehab and receiving, you know, a little bit of support for a wee time. You know, we need to be thinking about the longevity of that ongoing support. And I think the active outreach and referral to the lived experience recovery organisations is also important in this regard. And also in terms of improving aftercare, the £5 million improvement fund, of which £3 million was allocated to improve the quality of existing rehab services, that also includes improvements in preparation, outreach and aftercare as well.
Thank you. And before I call the next speaker, could I remind all members who wish to ask a question to please press the request to speak button. Not looking at anybody in particular who's not looking at me, so we'll see what happens there. Craig Hoy to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister conceded that one size does not fit all. So as the Government considers yet another structural overhaul of drug and alcohol support through the creation of a National Care Service, what assurance can she give that this further review will not simply result in more cuts and bad outcomes for those who require access to residential rehab and aftercare services?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, improving access and the capacity to residential rehabilitation is a key part of our national mission to tackle the drug deaths crisis. It's not the only part, as we've heard from others. There's an important in terms of harm reduction and community services. And what I've done in this post, with the support of the First Minister, is to make long-term funding commitments, both to ADPs, but also to the voluntary sector, who are often at the front line with the four new funds for people to apply to, whether that's the Recovery Fund, the Local Improvement Fund, the Service Improvement Fund, or indeed the Family and Children's Fund. And I absolutely concur with the point that this can never be about one size fits all. But we have a national emergency that requires national leadership. It does also require good partnership working on the ground and some bespoke arrangements. But I think Mr Hoy could equally criticise us if we were devolving or outsourcing decisions by government, that where we need to set an example and lead and fund and show direction, but also raise the bar about what's expected in every part of Scotland.
Audrey Nicol to be followed by Karen Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The proposal to increase capacity for residential rehabilitation and recovery is both welcome and timely. However, can I ask the Minister what provision will be made to include access so that the highest at risk individuals don't face barriers to access arising from preconditions for being alcohol or drug-free prior to their admission?
Minister.
Signing officer, there, as is set out clearly in the good practice guidelines that we published today, there is much more that we can do to remove the barriers, the unnecessary barriers that exist in referral criteria, admission criteria. And where this is most acutely felt is, of course, people with the most complex of needs, whether that's because they've got a history of homelessness, mental health problems, as well as issues with addictions. And, you know, while it will always be the case that services need to make judgments about entry criteria based on safety and efficiency and also with cognizance to the needs of other residents, it is therefore also important that, as well as our expansion of residential rehabilitation, which is for those who seek an abstinence-based recovery, that we are also looking at other models of care, whether that's other models of residential care or accommodation with support. And it's also one of the reasons that we are actively committed, and you've heard the announcement today in terms of the extra funding for LEAP and NHS Lothian, about why we are increasing funding to improve access to detox. But there is much more we can do in terms of that different range of services that can accommodate people safely who are not pursuing an abstinence-based recovery.
Karen Mochan to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the wake of the developing situation surrounding the Omicron variant, could the Minister inform Parliament how many individuals in residential rehabilitation have received both doses of the COVID-19 vaccine? How many residents in rehabilitation centres have adequate testing and vaccination services available to them? And finally, Minister, what has been put in place to make sure that residents get the booster in good time?
Minister.
Thank you very much for that question. We published a status report maybe 6 to 8 weeks ago. I will send that information to Ms Mochan. But as a result of that information that demonstrated that vaccination levels within people who were accessing residential rehabilitation were not as great as the general population or in accordance with various clinical priorities and age groups. As a result of that, we undertook a range of actions. So new guidance has been issued to health boards. We have been proactive in arranging for guidance and testing kits to be sent to residential rehabilitation. We have also provided some kind of training and support for people to access via webinars and such like. But it is an area that we are taking, I can assure you, a very active interest. Because this is about access to healthcare, and all NHS boards, as part of their bigger vaccination programme, have, as part of those plans, how they will reach people that is harder for services to reach, and we're taking a very close interest in this. Indeed, this is about people's rights to access the same healthcare that you and I have the absolute right to get as well.
Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Alex Gilhamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, as you know, Phoenix Futures plan to open a national drug rehabilitation centre on the site of the former Seagate Care Home in Saulcoats in my constituency, backed by the Scottish Government. However, they won't consult the local community. Instead, they'll contact neighbours and elected representatives to help them understand what they do. I, for one, am still waiting. Does the Minister agree that a new development of this nature and scale must be consulted on, not least to ensure that any local concerns are taken on board and addressed, scotch any misunderstandings and ensure that such a project becomes part of the Solcoats community and not just located in it?
Minister.
So I appreciate that, those points, Mr Gibson. As I said earlier to Mr Hoy, we have a national crisis that requires a national mission, and that does indeed require national leadership and decisions to be taken at a national level. Saying that, I think I would always be the first to recognise that we can all work harder to improve our partnership working. And in that vein, I recently met with councillors from North Ayrshire and also Phoenix Futures, who will deliver on this project, to discuss the plans for consultation as well as community engagement. And it's important to recognise that, you know, that there are local opportunities and local benefits of having a national service in your facility, in your area, and that was, you know, a huge focus of our discussions with the local councillors. I'm confident that Phoenix Futures have a really well-established approach to carrying out things like community impact assessments and consultations for projects such as this. They have been running a very similar family service in Sheffield now for 25 years, and I would expect this new national centre in Scotland to follow in this example. If there is further, if I can assist in any further way to Mr Gibson to reassure his constituents, I most certainly will. But can I say I was very proud that this new national service was the first project that we announced as part of our rapid residential rehabilitation increase in capacity programme, because we all have obligations to keep the promise. And there was a gap in services for families, and we know that fear of what will happen to one's children is very much a barrier to women in particular to coming forward and seeking the assistance they need. And this is a real good opportunity for us to start breaking the cycle, but also to keep the promise.
Thank you. Before I call the next speaker, could I remind the Minister that I'm very well aware of the importance of the subject and the comprehensive nature of the detail that the Minister wishes to provide to the Chamber in responding to questions. We have very limited time and still quite a few people who wish to ask a question. Thank you. Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for advance sight of her statement? And she knows she carries the good wishes of this entire chamber towards the end she's described. We still face a problem of global proportions. We're still the worst in the world. And as such, our response to it needs to be equal to that. I'm very grateful to see the government commit to increasing our rehabilitation places to 1,000. But I'm very concerned that it will take us till 2026, 5 years, to get to that number. People are dying today. So can I ask the Minister, what is keeping us? Why is this going to take so long to deliver?
Minister.
For the sake of brevity, Presiding Officer, perhaps I could emphasise to Mr Cole-Hamilton that we have taken significant steps forward without detracting always from the need to do more and to go further and faster. But as the first stage of our residential rehab programme, we have committed £18 million. This will add an additional 77 beds. It will increase capacity by 18% and will provide 450 more placements over time. And this is an important first step. I don't demur from the fact that there are other steps we need to take quickly. And part of that is about the whole systems approach. And within, I think, the next fortnight, I come back to Parliament to make a statement in and around progress around, for example, medication-assisted treatment standards.
Emma Harper to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
I would like to commend all parties' work across Chamber for taking a united approach to tackling drug-related deaths in Scotland. And we have to use every opportunity at our disposal to identify those at risk and meaningfully signposting people to support services. Is the Minister in a position to provide an update on engagement with her UK government counterparts on proposals to introduce safe consumption facilities in Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I continue to take two approaches. On the one hand, I do indeed continue to engage with the UK government on the evidence, not on the politics. And I recently attended the UK Drugs Summit and also at that time published an evidence paper in support of safer drug consumption facilities. Recently, on the back of comments from Douglas Ross and the Conservatives' shift in position, I did take the opportunity to write back to the Minister, Kit Malthouse, to see if that could encourage a similar change in heart from the UK government. But as Chamber also knows, I'm also determined to do as much as we can within our own powers. And, you know, the Lord Advocate's statement with regards to safer drug consumption facilities is helpful, as it is to be welcomed, and we are working through the detail of a proposition to pursue within our own powers.
Gillian Mackay to be followed by Brian Bitto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Public Health Scotland published statistics today that state that 12 alcohol and drug partnerships, including North and South Lanarkshire in my region, did not provide data on the numbers of people entering residential rehab, and that one of the reasons for this was patients not meeting the abstinence requirements. Can the Minister advise what other treatment options are provided to individuals in those circumstances so that they are not being turned away with no follow-up support?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me repeat again, it won't be acceptable for any part of the country not to be investing in residential rehab. Saying that, I also recognise that residential rehab is not for everyone, and that's why we are taking a whole systems approach, that we need treatment and recovery services, both different models of care within a residential nature, but also within community settings.
And Brian Whittle to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Minister suggested, Scotland has a shockingly high number of drug deaths, so it can come as no surprise that they also have a similarly high proportion of deaths within the homeless community, with over 50% of homeless deaths being drug-related. So can I ask the Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to tackle drug deaths within the homeless community, reach out to this community, ensure that they have access to rehabilitation services?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, Mr Whittle is absolutely correct when he says this is about how services reach out to people who have more complex needs. Some of the work that is started in Dundee that is overseen by Health Improvement Scotland that was very much focused on, for example, that integration of addiction and mental health services. We know the connection between problems with addiction, mental health and homelessness. So we really do need that full spectrum of services, but it also needs to be far better connected. And as a result of that work that started in Dundee, an additional four health boards have taken that approach. There's a 2.2 million project that has expanded that work that is essentially about the better integration of services so that services can reach those most in need and to remove barriers where they exist.
And Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to remind the Chamber I'm a member of the Moving On Inverclyde, the local addiction service. The Minister will be aware of some of the issues I've raised with her in the past, and on this, there won't be many individuals who have an addiction to prescription drugs, such as benzos, as well as many others who have got addiction to street drugs. Will any increase in the residential rehabilitation spaces ensure that there are sufficient spaces for those with an addiction to prescription drugs?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the guidance on good practice pathways emphasises the need to facilitate access to residential rehab for all individuals, no matter what type of substance they are engaged in. Our research did show that there are, you know, particular barriers around, you know, the use of benzodiazepines that have specific risks around detox, and the very germane issue in terms of drug deaths in Scotland is the polydrug use. People's use of substance shouldn't be a barrier to access and rehab.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the statement. I will allow a very short pause to enable frontbenchers to move seats if they wish to do so. Thank you. Before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.